Hi guys, good morning. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Right. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, hope you understood what we saw in last class, right? We saw certain very, very important things which you'll be using in your chemistry throughout your 11th and 12th, right? So, we saw how to write the electronic configuration in terms of orbitals, that is SPDF, right? Okay, so can I ask you some questions and then we'll start? Like, fine, let me ask, fine, Mithun, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what do you mean by half-filled stability and which cases will you be using it?
Sir, if the first three orbits are filled, then it is called half-stable stability, sir.
Okay, out of SPD, for which two orbitals will be using half-filled stability?
SP, sir.
S and P you will be using half-filled stability. That means you say that if at all I have one electron in S orbital, is that half-filled stable?
Actually, the voice is breaking for me, sir.
Sorry?
The voice is breaking for me, sir. I am not able to hear it properly.
Your voice is breaking for you. Okay, my voice is breaking for you. Oh, okay. Even Pranav says that. I think you can rejoin, Kanna. I think there'll be a guys. For how about everyone else? How is my voice?
For me, it's normal, sir.
Then I think you have to refresh your internet or something, Kanna. But then, is it fine? Okay, is it fine now? Okay, fine. So what I was asking is, if you said that half fill stability is applicable,
they're highly stable.
No, what I'm asking is, you said that half fill stability will be applicable for S and P. That's what you said, isn't it? So you say that if at all I have only one electron in S orbital, S orbital can have a maximum of two electrons, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right, so if you have only one electron in S, is it half-filled stability?
No, sir.
No. So which two orbitals will be using then?
P and D, sir.
Good. Right, so you will be using half-filled stability for P and D orbitals. Right. So how many electrons in P if it is to have half-filled stability?
2+1, 3, sir.
3 electrons. Totally 6 electrons can be placed in P. And if at all you find that the half shell is containing only 3 electrons, then it is half-filled stable, right? So can you tell me any element, if you can remember, what was that element which was having half-filled P stability?
Which shell, sir?
Like I'm asking, P3, that is half-filled stability for P, comes for which element?
Boron, beryllium, sorry, sir. Lithium.
Lithium has half-filled stability.
Wait, sir. Hydrogen.
Sir, it is nitrogen.
Nitrogen, sir.
Very good. So it is nitrogen, right? So nitrogen, what is atomic number? Nitrogen atomic number is 7. So I have 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. See, I have 2p3 here, right? So it is half-filled stable, right? Okay.
Oxygen
will have what? Oxygen will have atomic number of 8. So it will have 2p4. No, it is not half filled stable.
Okay, sir.
Right? Okay. Then when I go to D block elements, right? So what are D block elements? Basically, your atomic numbers of 21 to 30. These are what are called as D block elements. So there, we did something strange, right? So I expect one electronic configuration, but I change the electronic configuration because of half-filled stability. For which element can you remember? For
chromium, sir.
Okay. One is chromium. Another one?
Copper.
Copper.
Good. Very good. So for chromium, basically, I'll have 1s2, 2s2, 3s2, up to 3p6. And if actually the what I configuration I expect is 4s2, 3d4. But I will not write it like this. I will write it as 4s1, 3d5, because if I write 3d5, it is going to give me half-filled stability. Correct? Right? This is what we did for chromium. And same way for copper, I'll have 1s2, 2s2 all the together till through 3p6. What I expect is 4s2, 3d9. But how will I write the configuration? I'll write it as 4s1,
3d10.
Again, it is going to have fully filled stability in this case. Understood, right?
Yes,
so
yes.
I think the everything you have to now from now on, electronic configuration means it is going to be in terms of SNPD, SPDF. Like you should forget the things you have learned in your lower classes anymore. Understood. So yeah, and with the, okay. Well, we have still more questions. Abhishek. Abhishek,
sir.
Are you okay with? Okay, fine. Can you tell me what is the shape of S orbital? What is the shape of S orbital, Abhishek?
One second, sir.
Yeah.
Sorry, sir. I don't know, sir.
No problem. Okay. Say, I'll ask Suryamuthu. Surya, are you there? Pranav, not able to. You rejoin again, Tana. Yes, you rejoin again, Pranav. So yeah, whom I was asking Surya. Surya, are you there? Okay. Guys, okay. Fine, cool. So can I ask Bhavadharani?
So the same question, sir.
Same question. What is the shape of S orbital?
A spherical, sir.
Good, right? So the S orbital has spherical shape.
Spherical shape.
Very good. Whom can I ask? Can I ask Rohan?
Yes, sir.
Rohan, what is the shape of P orbital?
Dumbbell shape, sir.
Very good. It is dumbbell shaped. So what do you mean by a node, Kanna? What do you mean by a node?
Space in between things. It's the place where you can find electrons.
Where I can find electrons.
No, sir.
Exact opposite you're telling. What is the exact definition?
Where we can't find electrons.
Probability of finding electron is zero, sir.
That is the exact definition. Right? So, a node is a place. A node is a point or a plane or whatever it is. Right? Where the probability of finding the electron is zero. That means what? You will not be able to find electrons there for sure. Right? Fine. So, if you can recollect and tell me, where was the nodal points in P orbitals?
In origin.
Origin.
Exactly, right? At the origin, I can see that. So what I'm trying to tell you is, wherever you see the shaded region, wherever the region is shaded, that regions I will have electron. And whichever regions are not shaded, whichever there is no shape, basically those points corresponds to nodes. And obviously you can see that for P orbital, something like this will be there. So at the center of this lobes, that is at the origin, you will find that there'll be a node, right? Fine. And I told you that there'll be, okay, this is out of your portions, but still, let me see. Shruti?
I have a doubt, actually.
S Kana. S Rohan, tell me.
Sir, in S orbital, are there any nodes?
Actually, there are nodes, but now that's what I told you. There are two types of nodes. Okay, fine. Let Shruti answer the question. Then I'll answer this question. Yes, Shruti, can you remember and tell me what are the two types of nodes?
Radial nodes and angular nodes.
Okay, very good. Right? There are two types of nodes called as radial nodes and angular nodes. Right? So, Rohan, coming back to your question. Right? So, if I have 1s orbital, 1s orbital is completely, like, basically it is a full sphere, like this fully shaded. So, it doesn't have any nodes. Right? This is for 1s. But if I go for 2s, right? So if I go for 2s, there'll be something like this, right? So there'll be something like this, where this portion is shaded, right? This portion is shaded, but the space between two circles here, that is actually a node, right? That is actually a node, right? So these kind of nodes are what are called as radial nodes, right? Okay. These kind of nodes are what are called as radial nodes. This will happen in 2S, right? And in 3S, you will have two radial nodes. Like that, I'll be able to enter, right? And whatever you see in P orbitals, that is at the center of the origin, you have a nodal point that is called angular nodes.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so yeah, S orbitals do have nodes. It's not like they don't have nodes. They do have.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. Yes, so I think this is what we saw last class. I think, D orbital is left. Pranav, are you able to hear me now? Can you speak? Pranav? Okay, I think he's not able to speak. I think Shruti answered a very small question. Oh, Pranav, but you're not able to speak, Pranav. You'll not be able to speak. Ah, you just unmute yourself and speak, no, please. Mic isn't working. Okay, fine. So you can tell me in the chat itself. Can you tell me what are the 5D orbitals' name, Pranav? Let me think. Okay, sure. DYZ, yes. DXY, YZ, ZX, then? DZ squared, okay. Super. DX squared minus Y squared. Yes, these are the 5D orbitals. Very good, Pranav, right? So I have DXY, DYZ, DZX, DX squared minus Y squared, and DZ squared. These are all the 5 orbitals. And out of them, only one of them, okay, first, generally, okay, wait, let me ask Shruti again. So Shruti, out of all these 5D orbitals, 4 of them will have double, okay, first, generally, what is the shape of D orbitals?
Double shape.
Cool, double shape is correct. Out of them, out of these 5, only 4 of them have double, which doesn't have double?
DZ square. It has a ring like surrounding the lobe.
Good. So basically, out of these 5D orbitals, 4D orbitals have double shaped, right? But DZ squared has only one double, but there's a ring surrounding your DZ squared, right? So that is, again, there you will have an angular radial node. In DZ squared alone, you will have a angular node present because there's a ring kind of structure. Anyways, so yeah, I think everybody understood very good. I'm very happy, right? So that's about your chapter, right? So we'll move on to the next chapter. So next chapter, you have already studied in your 10th class. And it's periodic table. That too, we are going to specifically study about a modern periodic table, right? So you have already, you know what is the history, isn't it? Right? Why we are going for classification? Why do we have a periodic table? Yes, can you tell me, can someone tell me why we are going for periodic tables? Why are we classifying elements like this?
To study its properties more easier.
Exactly, right? So if I'm able to club them, all the elements which are having similar properties, if I'm able to club them, right? It is easy for us to study them better, isn't it? So that's why we go for clubbing them, or say classification of elements, that's why we go, right? So there have been so many attempts in history, isn't it? There have been so many attempts by scientists in history to get this classification of elements done, right? So you know what are the histories, right? So first, starting with Dobryniner, right? There was something called as Dobryniner's triads. And in that, I know what he did. He just grouped elements into groups of three elements, isn't it? Lithium, sodium, potassium, like that he grouped elements, right? So again, it was based on atomic masses, right? There's something called as periodic functions, right? What do you mean by periodic functions? Periodic functions are the one which is responsible for these elements to have similar properties, right? So periodic function in your Dobrynin's triads, what basic principle he took is your atomic mass, right? So I hope you remember what happened in Dobrynin's triads. If I take the first element and the third element and I take the average atomic mass of them, I'm going to get the second element's atomic mass. So that also you would have studied, right? So there are so many problems with Dobrynin's, isn't it? So that particular thing, that average atomic mass, whatever I'm telling, was not working for every triad. He had so many triads, but only for two or three triads, that particular thing was working, right? That is the atomic mass of first element, second element summed up together and took in the average, right? So I'm going to get the atomic mass of second element. That was not happening for every triad. It was happening for very few number of triads, right? And second problem with Dobrynin's triads was he was not able to play, if at all, any new elements were discovered, right? There was no space in Dobrynin's triads for me to accommodate those elements there, right? So that was also a problem. And since Dobrynin's triads used atomic masses as the periodic function, right? Isotopes are a problem, isn't it? Isotopes are the species having same atomic number, but different mass number or different atomic mass, right? So for different isotopes, I should have different places to be accommodated in the Dobrynin's triads since he is using atomic masses, right? So these were the few problems which were there for Dobrynin's triads. Then some guy came named Newland, right? So Newland's law of octaves, they call it, right? So he said that he just took the help of musical notes, right? So how we have Sa, Re, Gamma, Pa, Dha, Ni, right? So after every seventh note, after every eighth note, the thing repeats, isn't it? Sa comes after every seventh swara, right? Okay, so he based on that, he said that again, every eighth element, starting from, if I arrange them in the order of, basically what Newland said, is that if the elements are arranged in the ascending order of atomic numbers, if I arrange them in the ascending order of atomic numbers, every eighth element, right? Every eighth element will show similar properties. That's what he said, right? There is no scientific explanation for why he did like that, right? He used those musical notes, right? And eventually it turned out to be correct also. Like every eighth element actually had little similar properties, right? So again, there was a problem because he used atomic mass there, right? He didn't use atomic numbers, atomic mass, again, problems of isotopes, right? And again, the space for new elements to be found out was not there in your Newland's laws of octaves, right? So again, those are so many problems, right? And lastly, I went for, what is the name?
Mendeleev.
Ah, yes, thank you. Right, Mendeleev, right? So Mendeleev, okay, so Mendeleev was the next guy, right? So Mendeleev was the first one to talk about certain technical terms called as groups and periods, right? So he also took the idea from Newland's laws of octaves, right? So he made a column, he made a table, right? So in that table, he called the columns as groups and the rows as periods, right? So again, he used the periodic function to be atomic masses, right? He used the periodic function to be atomic masses. So again, like, you know how it looks, that actually Mendeleev's periodic table is now the basis for your modern periodic table, except that I am not going to use atomic masses. I'm actually going to use atomic numbers rather than atomic masses. So the problem of isotopes is not a problem, isn't it? Because isotopes for different... Sir, we studied mostly... okay, I'll tell you what is Moseley did. Moseley is what is a modern periodic table, right? Moseley, along with your Lothar-Mayer curves. Okay, we'll speak about it. Wait, I'll come to that. So in Mendeleev's, like the only great advantage I had in Mendeleev was he was the first scientist who gave space for the new element to found out. If at all a new element is found out or discovered, right? So there were spaces in the Mendeleev's periodic table for them to get placed there, right? So for example, he after boron, he gave a space. So that is that he called it as Eka boron, and after some time it was found to be aluminium, and aluminium was placed there, right? And then there was something called as after silicon, he gave a space, it was called as Eka silicon, right? So after that, that element was found out to be germanium, right? So like that is the main advantage of Mendeleev's periodic table, right? Fine. So till now, whatever we saw, right, all of them, the periodic functions were basically atomic masses, right? So scientists thought that the property of the elements, right, the chemical properties of the elements are determined by their atomic masses. That's what scientists thought, right? Until this guy called as Lothar Mayer came, right? So Lothar Mayer, what he did is basically, he put a graph, it's called as Lothar Mayer curves, right? So he took atomic number in the z-axis, right? And some property of the element, right? So he said that the graph is a little complicated. We will not look into it. It's not required for you also. So what he understood from the graph is that it is actually not atomic masses, right? It is not actually the atomic masses which defines the chemical properties of elements. It is actually the atomic numbers which are more efficient in deciding the chemical properties of the elements, right? From the Lothar-Mayer curves, right? And this, from this idea only, or Moseley. So Moseley is the guy who, Moseley. So Moseley was the guy who actually took the idea from Lothar-Mayer curves, that basically said that the periodic functions are not atomic masses. There is going to be atomic numbers. And based on that, he gave the new modern periodic table. Right? That was the new guy. Right? And for his table only, that is the modern periodic table only, we are going to study about everything from top to bottom, everything we're going to study now. Okay, fine. Now you already have an idea of how the periodic table looks, isn't it? Right? So we'll look into it. Right? So the columns, vertical columns, which are there in the periodic table are what are called as groups. And the periods, I mean, basically the horizontal rows are what are called as periods in modern periodic table. It's again the idea taken from Mendeleev's, right? Okay. So guys, how many groups are there in modern periodic table? How many groups?
18.
Good. There are 18 groups in modern periodic table. So starting with group 1, group 2. So I can actually understand that it is going to look something like this. So this is the skeleton of the modern periodic table, isn't it? Say here I'll have group 1, group 2, and here I will have from group 3 to group 12 in this, right? And then I will have here group 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this many groups will be there, right? So these are all the group numbers starting from group 1 to group 18. Correct? Okay. Fine. How many periods, guys?
Seven.
Yeah, seven periods. Seven periods? Yes, seven periods. Right? You will have seven periods means you will have seven vertical horizontal columns like this. Okay? Right. Say for example, if I see in the first period, say this is the first period. Oh, wait. First period is actually top, isn't it? In first period, what are the two elements, guys?
Hydrogen, helium.
Good. So basically, I will have just two elements. Actually, I can just put one more extra box here, and I can put a box here. Right. So in this box, I'm going to have hydrogen, and in this box, I'm going to have helium. So what you can understand is, in the first horizontal row or in the first period, I have only two elements, and that is my hydrogen and helium. And how do you decide? So there is a formula by which you will be able to predict how many number of elements are there in each period. And your famous formula is 2n squared, where n is my period number. Right? Where n is my period number. Right? So 2 n squared, for example, if I take the first period, right, you will see that n is 1, that is the first period. So maximum number of elements in that particular period is 2, right? Now if I go to second period, right, second period is here. This is the second period, right? So here I'll have lithium, then comes beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. Yeah, these are all the 8 elements. Now 2 n squared, n will become 2, so 2 n squared will become 8. 8 elements in the second period.
Okay.
Right? Okay. Actually, did I do any mistake? Actually, this line should come here, guys. This is the line. Sorry. This is the line. Fully, this thing is fully occupied. Right? Okay. Next comes the third period. So after lithium it is sodium, after beryllium it is magnesium, and the 10 elements which I spoke, 21 to 30 is going to come here: scandium, titanium, vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc. Now you are opening your mouth, isn't it? How does he remember all this? It's because I have been doing this for a long time, right? So if you are also interested, actually I have a friend, okay, I have a friend named Vaseem who's also a chemistry faculty, right? So he's from Jammu and Kashmir, right? So his sister, right, is actually in some 5th or 6th standard, okay? His sister is basically some 5th or 6th standard. So he actually told that her sister has a very peculiar talent. So the talent is, she will be able to tell the elements which are there in the entire periodic table, like say in the ascending order, starting with hydrogen, ending with the end element, she'll be able to tell in like 30 seconds, like that. Okay, I'll not be able to really tell in this speed, right? And the most important thing is, she'll be able to tell it in reverse also. Starting with the last element, she'll be able to end up with helium, right? So that kind of talent and all people have, right, in periodic table, okay? So if you can, you can actually remember every element in the periodic table. But for now, it is difficult because now only you're starting. You don't worry much about it, right? So what I would suggest is, at least for now, you need to know group 1, group 2, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 completely. This area you can leave. That is group 3 to group 12. For now, actually, you can leave out. Okay, but it's for now again. You will be again studying them in your 12th class. So I can also say in reverse, oh, yes, Mithun, someday, like if your mic is working, I can actually, I would love to hear it if you can tell it in reverse all the elements. Okay, or you send me a voice note. Not by seeing, correct. Obviously, you should not see and tell. Right? So anyways, right, so Mithun, you can send me a voice note also in your Wi-Fi. You have my number. You can send me a voice note in WhatsApp. I would love to listen to it. Right, fine. Okay, so what I was telling, yeah. So first is sodium, magnesium, and basically here I'll have the D block elements, which I don't want to worry about now. I don't want to speak about it. So after magnesium, okay, basically after boron, I'll have aluminium. After carbon, silicon, nitrogen, phosphorus. What is this? Oxygen, sulfur, fluorine, chlorine. After neon, it's argon. So these are the elements in the second period, right? Okay, next. Actually, I will do only this. I don't want to speak about this, right? Okay, so after sodium, it is potassium. After magnesium, it is calcium. And after aluminium, it is gallium, silicon, germanium, phosphorus, arsenic, for sulfur, selenium, for chlorine, bromine, for argon, neon, argon, krypton, right? And then, okay, fine. So this is the minimum requirement, guys. This is the minimum requirement which you need to know now, right? The minimum requirement is you have to know at least 3 periods. Minimum requirement, right? You have to know at least in each and every group. So basically in the first group, you need no three elements, lithium, sodium, potassium. In second group, three elements again, beryllium, magnesium, calcium. And in third, beryllium, aluminium, gallium, like this. In every group, first three elements, at least, you need to know. It's very, very important. Okay? If at all you can remember all the seven, wonderful. Go for it. Right? So anyways, I will try to tell you other four elements, how much ever I remember. Okay? So fine. It's after potassium, it is rubidium. And after calcium, it is strontium, ST. Right? And then after beryllium, aluminium, gallium, it is, see, I myself forgot. Okay, I don't remember this. So after germanium, again, forgot. After arsenic, it is bismuth, right? After selenium, it is polonium. And after bromine, it is iodine. And after krypton, xenon, argon, krypton, xenon, right? So yeah, this is enough, right? You don't have to worry much about fourth period. I mean, basically fifth period. So until at least 1, 2, 3, 4 periods and 18 groups. Basically every group, three elements. Every group, three elements, you need to know. It's a must. If you don't remember that, your periodic table is going to be a little difficult. Okay, right. Fine. Now you already know how this arrangement came, isn't it? Right? So you know how, like, if you, like, based on your previous type of electronic configuration, you already know how this arrangement came, isn't it? Right? So tell me, what is one special thing which is going to happen for elements in the same period, guys?
Increase.
What increase?
Atomic. Total period or group?
In a group. Say I have lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium in the same group, right? What is common among them? That's what I'm asking.
The valence.
Valence electron.
Correct. So basically, all of these things, right? All the elements in the same group will have same number of valence electrons. That is the very, very important thing, right? Elements in the same group have same number of valence electrons. That is the last shell. The number of electrons in all these elements are same. Right? Okay. So you would have already done it. For example, say for lithium, it is 2,1. For sodium, it is 2,8,1. For this thing, it is 2,8,8,1. Like this, you would have written the electronic configurations before. Isn't it? Without your s and p orbitals, s and p, d, f, all that. Right? But from now on, we are not going to follow it. But still, the rule stays same, right? The number of valence electrons is going to be same in all of these group elements. That is going to be same, but we are not going to speak in terms of this. We are going to speak in terms of the orbitals, right? Okay, right. So this is the overall picture here. So I think I should rub it off so that I'll be able to explain you more. Say now, starting with, I'll start with group one elements, for example. So I have lithium, sodium, potassium. Lithium, sodium, potassium, right? Okay. Now, say lithium is having atomic number of 3, so it is going to have 1s2, 2s1, 1s2, 2s1, right? Same way, sodium will have atomic number of 11. So you see that it will have 1s2, 2s2, 2p3, 2p6, 3s1. So what do you see here? One electron in the s shell, valence s shell. Again, one electron in the valence s shell. Right? Same way. For this,
how much electron is the maximum, sir?
Sorry?
P shell. How much electrons can it hold maximum, sir?
6 electrons.
Okay, sir.
That is why we say when I have 3 electrons in P shell, it is half filled stable. Right? Okay. So this one will have 19, I guess. So I'll have 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. How many? 3s2, 3p6, 4s1. Right? So you can see that. potassium again is having 4s1. The last time it was 3s1. In lithium, it was 2s1. So can you tell me for rubidium, what will be the valence shell configuration? Guys?
5s2.
Super. So it will be 5s1. Are you able to understand now what is happening? Same rule only. For the elements in the same group, will have same number of valence electron. Here also it is same. Now you have, here you have to talk about the shells here. That is your orbitals here, right? The valence orbitals, the valence orbital in all these elements are s. You can see that, right? And all the s orbitals, valence s orbitals having one electron in them. Valence s orbitals having one electron in them. Correct? So now I'll go for the second group. We'll see what is happening there, okay? When I go for this, okay, if you can take this down or doesn't matter. So when I go for group two, say first one is beryllium, which is having atomic number of 2, right? So how will I write the configuration? 1s2, 2s2, no problem, right? So for magnesium, the atomic number is 12, that is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. Right, 3s2 is coming again. You can see 2s2 ending, 3s2 ending. Right, okay. Now for calcium. Again, I'll be able to, even if I don't know the atomic number for calcium, right, I will be able to predict what is the valence electron configuration if I know which group it belongs to. Correct, so it belongs to the group of magnesium and beryllium, so it has to end with 4s2, and obviously, other things would have been filled before. Right. Same way for strontium, it would have ended up with 5s2. Correct. Right.
So like this. What is the atomic number, sir?
Sorry.
Rubidium.
Rubidium. What is the atomic number? I'll be able to predict it if you want, but I don't know exactly. So if at all the until 5s1, so all the elements, all the atomic numbers would have been filled before. So you can calculate actually, okay, if you want to know it. Right. Right. So yeah, that's about group two. So in group two, what you see is that all the valence shell s orbitals are having 2-2 electrons in them. Right. Now, if I go for, say, after I'll finish group two, now forget about group three. Okay. Group three to group 12, we'll not see now. Right. We'll go for group 13. That is that side, boron's family. Okay. So when I go for group three, definitely you're going to see that the electrons are going to enter. Say, for example, after 3s, they're going to go to 3p, right? Basically, after this, 2 electrons are over. So, for example, if I take beryllium here, and then I take boron, right? If I take boron, boron is having atomic number of 5, right? So, what do you see? It is having 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. Now, I enter the p orbital. Right? So, because 2 electrons are gotten over here, right? Same way, for magnesium, after that, the magnesium's next period would be beryllium, aluminium, right? So aluminium, what I can expect? 3s2 is over. So what will I go to the next one? That will be 3p1, right? So basically, what I'm trying to tell you is, if I go for group 13, I have boron to have 1s2, 2s2, 2p1 because the atomic number is 5, right? For aluminium, what will be? I'll be able to predict now. So whatever is going to come before 3p1, right? Same way for this thing, aluminium, gallium. Again, we'll have everything up to 4p1. Now, are you able to understand, guys? Basically, whatever the rule you studied actually stays exactly same. Except that we are going to speak in terms of orbitals or not orbits, right? We're going to speak in terms of SPDF. Okay, right? So now I'm going to give you the general electronic configuration, right? The general electronic configurations of all the groups, right? General electronic configuration of all the groups. And before going into this, right? Before going into this, you have to understand the certain groups together, say group 1 and group 2 are together called as something, right? And say group 13 to group 18 are together called as something, right? Now that's something, I'll tell you what is that. So remember, group 1 and group 2 together are what are called as S block elements, right? Group 1 and group 2 are what are called as s block elements. Now, how do you decide this? It's very simple. You have to see where the valence electron is going, right? So you can see in group 1, all of them had as 2s1, 3s1, 4s1, 5s1. That is how it was. So when I went to group 2, what I saw? I saw every element in the same group had s2 configuration. That is 2s2, 3s2, 4s2. Like that they had, right? So what do you see? It is all depending upon which orbital that valence electron goes. If it goes to the s orbital, it is going to be called as s block element. If the valence electron goes to the p orbital, it is called a p block element. So I can say that group 13 to 18, what do you saw in group 13? The electron was going to 2p1. Right now, when I go for group 14, you will have 2p2, next one 2p3, 2p4, 2p5, 2p6. The last neon will have 2p6, fully filled configuration. Right, so those 13 to 18 elements are going to be called as p block elements. Why? Because the valence electron is going to the p orbital, not s orbital. The valence shell you'll find the electronic configuration, valence electronic configuration to be p1, p2, p3, like that. Right, and yes, group lastly, whatever I'm left out with, that is group 3 to 12, that we saw a gap, right? Now these are going to be called as D and F block elements. So here the electrons are going to go to, the valence electrons are going to go to D and F block. So they're going to be called as D and F block elements, right? So this is how the whole periodic table is now segregated, right? S block elements, P block elements, and D and F block elements, right? So you will have a chapter. Basically, now you'll study the periodic table as a whole, right? As a whole thing, you'll study the properties and all that. So in your 11th class, you'll be studying about this group 1 and group 2 in depth, their chemical properties, the compounds found by them, everything in depth you'll study. In your 12th class, you'll be studying group 1, group 2, group 13, and 14 in 11th class, right? And you'll be studying the rest, that is your group 15, 16, 17, 18, and this D and F block elements in your 12th class. In depth, you'll be studying, right? So for now, we are going to see only the overall properties of the periodic table, okay? So guys, any doubts till now? Why am I calling S block, P block, D block? Everybody understood? Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, cool. Now we understood this. Now I'm going to give you for each and every group, right? For each and every group, how we are going to write the general electronic configuration. Right? What do you mean by general electronic configuration? You'll see that. Right. Say first for group 1. Right. So basically, general electronic configuration means general valence electron configuration, like how the valence electronic configuration is going to look, right? Now I'll be able to write it like this. I'll be able to write it as NS1. Are you able to correlate whatever I'm doing here to whatever you saw for group 1 elements? You saw for all the group 1 elements that the valence electronic configuration was 1s1, 2s1, 3s1, like that it was, right? So generally, how will I be able to represent the valence electron configuration? Like ns1, where n is the period number, right? For example, if it is hydrogen is in the first period. So what will be the electronic configuration there? 1s1. For lithium is in the second period. So its valence electronic configuration would be 2s1. For sodium is in the third period. So the valence electronic configuration would be 3s1. Like that, I'll be able to predict. You have to know this, the general valence electron configuration, right? For all the groups. Say for group 2, it'll be ns2. Right? For group 2, it'll be ns2. For group 13, like, see, people will tend to do this mistake. After group 2, our natural tendency would be to go to group 3. But group 3, we are not going to speak. We are going to directly go to group 13. Okay, fine. So now group 13 will have NS2, NT1. You saw for boron how it was. Boron family, boron, aluminium, gallium had 2P1, 3P1, 4P1, like that. This is the valence electron configuration. And n is the previous. Obviously, after finishing s orbital only, you can go to p orbital. So why am I representing both the things? Is that because both of them have same principal quantum number. Both of them belong to the same main shell. That's why I write both s well as p. Okay? Right? So next, group 14 will have NH2, NP2. Say, for example, if you want to say, what is that? Prove it. So I can, that is basically carbon family. Group 14 is carbon family. So you can see carbon is having atomic number of 6, 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. So you can see NH2, NP2, 2s2, 2p2. Right? Say for silicon, you will have basically what? 3s2, 3p2, and all others are filled before. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, done. Then I go for 3s2, 3p2. Right. Okay. Next, for group 15, I have NH2, NP3, and this is my nitrogen family. Nitrogen, I already told you, half filled stability. So all the elements in nitrogen family actually will have half filled stability. Is it not? Right. All the elements in the nitrogen family, that is group 15, right, will have half filled stability because they're having P3 configuration. Half filled stability comes. Right. So for nitrogen, I know how the configuration is: 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. For phosphorus, I don't have to know anything. I can directly go for 3s2, 3p3, and for the next element would be 4s2, 4p3. Like where n is the period number again. N is the period number. Right. Next, for group 16, is oxygen family, so it will have NH2, NP4. Right. You can check how it's NP4. For oxygen, it is 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. For sulfur, how is it going to be? For sulfur, it is going to end with 3s2, 3p4. So all the other things can be calculated. And the next element would have had 4s2, 4p4. Right? Okay. Next, for group 17, it is NS2, NP5. NS2, NP5. Isn't it? Right, now this belongs to my fluorine family. So fluorine is going to have 1s2, 2s2, 2p5, atomic number 9. Total 9 electrons are there. Right. So for chlorine, I'll be able to predict it as 3s2, 3p5. And for bromine, it is going to be 4s2, 4p5. For iron, it is going to be 5s2, 5p5. Right. Okay, now lastly, group 18 alone is remaining. I'll write it here. So for group 18, it's fully filled configuration. NS2, NP6. So for neon, if I take neon, will have 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. So you can see NS2, NP6, 2s2, 2p6. Argon will have 3s2, 3p6. Krypton, neon, argon, krypton will have 4s2, 4p6. All these things are done, right? So guys, you have to remember this. You have to remember the valence electronic configuration. Right, because like the thing is, every time, sometimes if we don't remember the atomic numbers of certain elements, right, at least if you remember which group and period they belong to, at least not even group, which group they belong to, at least that you remember, you can actually predict what will be the atomic number along with the basically, because you will know what is the valence electron configuration, definitely, right, and you obviously know what all the other things which are filled before this, right. So you'll be able to easily calculate the atomic numbers, even if you don't remember the atomic numbers directly. But what you have to remember? You have to remember where exactly the element is present, which group it belongs to at least. That if you know, easily you'll be able to predict the atomic numbers, right? Okay, so actually I'm going to stop the class now, right? In next class, right, what we are going to do is, we are going to see a trick, right? We are going to see a trick. If I give you the atomic number, you will be able to predict which group number and period number in the periodic table that particular element is present. That you'll be able to predict it. Okay. Again, I repeat. I'm going to give you the atomic number and you will be able to predict where exactly the element is there in the periodic table. Which group number, which period number, all these things you'll be able to get it out. Or say the opposite. If I give you the group number and period number, I'm saying that the element is in fifth period, seventh group, something like that, I'm telling. You will be able to predict what is the atomic number. That also you'll be able to do. Okay. So hopefully, till now, no doubts, guys. right? So next class is going to be a little interesting, right? This we'll do, and then we'll go for other properties, how the along the period, how is it varying, along the group, how is it varying, and most of the things you already studied, and little more extra things we'll be studying. Okay?
Yes.
Fine? Sir. Right. So fine, guys. Thank you so much. We'll meet again day after tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.